In this video, we'll discuss quantum computation. I would like us to start with a sort of popular presentation of quantum computing and then go in depth into its theory and practical exercises. Now, I must warn you that quantum computing is a supremely vast topic, and there are hundreds of books written about it. And of course, I'm not going to cover the entire subject. However, I have recently written a review paper on quantum computation. And those of you who are interested, I'd like to refer to that paper. The link is in the introduction. The paper is different in that it has almost no formulas. So it is very popular. It is accessible to those readers who do not have special education in quantum physics, and hence, if you are interested to learn more about quantum computing and its current status, you're welcome to read this formula. So, as you must have seen in popular literature, the difference between the quantum and classical computer is that while the unit of information in a classical computer is the bit, which can either take the value of 0 or 1. In a quantum computer, the main bit of information is the qubit that can be in a superposition state of 0 plus 1. And we've discussed qubits a lot in our course. You know that the polarization of a photon is an example of a qubit, right? So general, if you don't remember, the general definition of the qubit is a two-dimensional Hilbert space. So there are many other implementations of a qubit. One of them here, it's an atom which can be in a superposition of ground and excited state, and there are many more. Now, an obvious question that can arise is, what's the benefit? You know, okay, the classical bit has a well-defined state of either 0 or 1, but what's the benefit of the superposition state? Like, we can have a dead cat or a living cat, but what's the benefit of a half-dead cat? And the answer is, if it's just one qubit, indeed there is not much benefit. The benefit arises if we have multiple qubits, such as in the case of four qubits, for example, four qubits can be in an entangled state. You see 0, 0, 0, plus 1, 1, 1, 1. And you can see that this state of four qubits already does carry some information, right? And before I explain why such entangled states have advantage in terms of information processing, let me just say what the quantum, let me define the quantum computer, quantum register. In fact, there are many different models, many different implementations of a quantum computer, but in a simplified way, one can define a quantum computer, or rather the register of the quantum computer, as a system of qubits that interact in a controlled manner. Now, this here is an extremely, extremely oversimplified example of the benefit of quantum computation, of entanglement. Think of a telephone book. So you have a city with a million people, and each person has an entry in the phone book, say, in the name, which is 10 bytes, and then the phone number, which is 7 bytes, right? So each entry is 17 bytes, it's a million people, so 17 megabytes is a classical telephone book. But now, let's ask ourselves, how can we record this information in a quantum register? And the answer is, we can actually record it as a superposition of all these entries, right? So we can think of 17 quantum bytes carrying all these names and numbers in a superposition state, like this. So instead of 17 classical megabytes, we have only 17 quantum bytes, right? You see massive advantage in information storage, but in fact, this advantage is not only in storage, it's also in computation. Because suppose, for example, that you want to either change, you know, add one to one of the numbers here, or include an area code or something. You want to modify all entries in your phone book in the same way. In the classical book, you'd want to make these modifications one by one, so you'd want to reprint the entire book. In a quantum register, you would need to just apply this this change, this computation, just one time, and it will automatically act on every element of the superposition. So in this way, the quantum computer allows you to perform a computation in a superposition state, right? It allows you to solve multiple problems, multiple similar problems in a superposition state. So quantum technology allows you massive parallelism, not only in storage of information, but also in computation. Now, as you can imagine, a machine like this has multiple applications. Applications include optimization or modeling of nature or machine learning, a variety of applications. But in fact, you know, I can hear this question quite often. Okay, fine, quantum computer is great, but when will it be there? When will it replace my desktop or my laptop? And the answer is probably never. Because you see, you don't really use your computer for calculation. You use your computer to store and exchange and process information, but not for calculations. A quantum computer is a specific machine for calculations. But even if we look at pure computational tasks, we'll see that there is a problem. As I said, a quantum computer is able to solve computational problems. Is able to solve multiple problems in a superposition state. But that means that the answer will also be in a superposition, right? But at a given time, you don't need the superposition state. You need just one answer to one particular problem that interests you at this moment. If we go back to our phone book, you don't need a superposition of all names and numbers, right? You need only one number that corresponds to a given name. And how would you single out from this entangled mess the particular answer that you want is non-trivial. Therefore, quantum computer is not a universal panacea. It's only useful for a limited class of problems, some of which are listed here. And however, there is one more problem of entirely different nature. The problem looks quite insignificant. The problem of factoring large numbers. You've done this problem in school many times, I'm sure. But it turns out that to find prime factors of a very large number is an extremely computationally difficult problem. If a number is sufficiently large, then a classical computer can take years, or potentially more than the life of the universe, to solve this question. For a quantum computer, however, this problem is much, much easier. Now, that sounds insignificant. It sounds like a school exercise. However, it is hugely important. Why is it this way? Because, as we discussed, if you remember our lecture, our video on quantum cryptography, we also discussed modern techniques of encrypting information. And we said there are two techniques. One is one-time pad, and the other one is public key cryptography. And public key cryptography, which is universally applied in information exchange, in secure information exchange, because it's much cheaper, much less prohibitive than one-time pad. Public key cryptography, its security turns out to be based on certain mathematical functions being more difficult to compute one way than the other, such as multiplication of numbers versus factorization, right? It's very easy to multiply two prime numbers, however large they are. It is, however, very difficult to find the factors.
And this one-way nature of multiplication as a mathematical
turns out that
function.
This fact is the basis for the security for, of public key cryptography. Now, as I said, for one classical computer, there is no such asymmetry. For a quantum computer, it is quite easy, well, not extremely easy, but reasonably easy to decompose a number into its factors. And what that means that, well, speaking again, oversimplifying things, that we can say that whoever builds a quantum computer can either get all the money in all the banks, or all the military secrets of their opponents, whatever they prefer. Now, this is of course oversimplified, but in actuality, it's not too far oversimplified. Because, well, think of our today's society is really information-based. Information and security is the cornerstone of functionality of the society, right? There was this movie some 20 years ago. Bruce Willis was fighting a hacker who was, who hacked into a city infrastructure and basically paralyzed the entire function of the city, and as a result, paralyzed the entire country. And that was 20 years ago. Yeah, now, of course, the society is even more computerized. Well, just imagine what would happen if we lose proper information exchange, right? The power plants will stop, so we'll lose light. Food will no longer be delivered to supermarkets because all the logistic supply chains will no longer function. Rubbish will no longer be removed. Hospitals will stop working. Sanitation services will not work either. So, one can compare the quantum computer with the atomic bomb. Of course, there will be no radiation, no shockwave, so there will be no immediate destructive effects. No houses will be destroyed momentarily, but yet probably in a slightly longer period of time, an equally large number of people will die from hunger and diseases. So one should think of the quantum computer not just as a tool of creation, but also very much as a weapon of destruction. By the way, one of the primary effects of the quantum computer, of its power to decrypt public key communication algorithms, is the risk for blockchains. Yeah, as soon as, because the blockchain is entirely reliant on public key cryptography, so as soon as somebody develops a quantum computer, they'll immediately be able to impersonate any party on the network, and therefore the blockchain such as Bitcoin will immediately lose its value. The good news, of course, is that the quantum computer is quite difficult to build. As we discussed, large entangled systems are very fragile, right? Because they every interaction of any qubit with the outside world would essentially constitute a quantum measurement, which would essentially destroy the entanglement. So we have to restart the computation, start the calculation. So if you think of it, we'll go back to this picture, we need to make sure that our qubits are affected by other qubits that are very small, and yet not affected by the environment, which is much larger. This is, in a sense, an oxymoron, a contradictory task, and that's why the computer is so difficult to build. Like, one can say that's as difficult to build as a Schrödinger cat. And hence the current state of technology in quantum computation, the state is that we don't even know what physical platform is best useful for quantum computation. Now, what do I mean by this? Think of classical computing 100 years ago, right? People did not know. I mean, people had the concept of classical computation, but they did not know what to build their computer out of, right? So there were some mechanical models, some electric models, electromechanical, then vacuum tubes appeared, and then finally transistors appeared, and on top of these transistors, silicon microstructures were built, and people realized that silicon microstructures are in fact the optimal way to implement computation. So with quantum computers, we don't even know that, right? We don't even know what physical systems are best suitable. Different research groups all over the world are trying different systems, such as ion traps, superconducting circuits, optical systems, and so on. We don't even know who the winner is. Here are some of the largest quantum computers that were built in the world so far. First, there is Google that built a prototype of a universal quantum computer some 3 or 4 years ago already. And remarkably, they have demonstrated that for certain tasks that are completely useless, but still, for certain tasks, this computer showed remarkable advantage, major advantage, compared to its classical counterpart. So it was able to solve a certain task much faster than a classical supercomputer would ever be able to build. So that is kind of the characterization of the current state of affairs, right? That we are at the threshold of quantum advantage, of quantum computational advantage, but we have not yet reached it for classically useful tasks. So there is Google, then there is IBM, who more recently built a quantum computer with 127 qubits. And quite importantly, they also have set a smaller quantum computer with only 16 qubits into free access. In our next lecture, we'll practice using this computer to practice solving simple computational tasks. And then there is D-Wave, which has a special place. You see a huge number of qubits. Canadian company built this quantum computer with a huge number of qubits compared to those previous examples. But importantly, most physicists believe that this is not yet a universal quantum computer, and therefore its capability to achieve quantum advantage is similar, if not less, than those universal quantum computers that I mentioned previously. So to summarize, right, that's the current status, right? The different companies, different universities, different groups are trying to build different quantum computers, and then they say, okay, we built one computer with 53 qubits or 127 qubits or 5,000 qubits. Does it mean that if you have more qubits, you're the winner? The answer is no, that's not really true, because you see modern qubits, those qubits that are available for current quantum computers, they quickly decohere, that is, they interact with the environment so quickly that you cannot really implement a lot of calculation before you lose your quantum register and have to restart it. So the next goal at the moment is to build what we call a logical qubit, that is, implement error correction, that register where there would be multiple physical qubits, each of them will decohere, each of them will lose information, but because there's many of them, they support each other, and as a result, we still have a qubit, which kind of summarizes the information carried by all of these, but the state of the qubit can remain intact for a very long time by means of error correction. And that would be the next major step. We have not yet reached it, so what recently they demonstrated about a factor of 100 enhancement of lifetime of a qubit, which is of course significant, but not yet enough for practical quantum computation. We'll see first steps of practical quantum computation in the next few years.